Welcome back, geochemistry fans. Have you ever watched water boil? I bet you have. Fewer of us have boiled water at higher elevation, though. The higher you go in the atmosphere, the lower the pressure and the lower the temperature at which the water boils. Think about what boiling is, ripping water molecules apart with their jiggling motion, which increases with temperature. If the overall pressure of the environment is lower, the water molecules can rip apart more easily and boil at a lower temperature, and as pressure builds deeper in the earth, water has a harder time turning to steam and needs higher and higher temperature to do so. This is an easy chemical system for us to start with in exploring chemical equilibrium in rock-forming minerals that make up metamorphic rocks. Notice that we have one chemical component involved in turning water into steam, that being H2O. Also note that as we boil or condense water, we are at a temperature where both vapor and liquid phases are present, so we say there are two phases. Welcome to the phase rule, one of the most important concepts in all of metamorphic petrology. The formula, F equals C minus P plus 2, is shorthand for saying that the number of degrees of freedom in a chemical system is equal to the number of chemical components involved minus the number of phases, plus 2. Our system of water turning to steam, or vice versa, has one component minus two phases plus 2 to equal 1 degree of freedom. Let's explore each variable in the phase rule to get a deeper understanding. What do we mean when we say boiling water has 1 degree of freedom? It means we can have only one variable that we can independently vary, and then all other aspects of the system are dependent on that one single independent variable. In the case of boiling water, we choose to change the pressure of our system, and this predetermined at what temperature water would boil. That is where the liquid and gas water coexist. We could try choosing the temperature at which water would boil, and that would predetermine at what pressure the system has to be. Only one variable can be changed independently, and all other parameters are set to that 1 degree of freedom. The phases in the phase rule referred to not only solid versus liquid versus vapor, but also the variety of individual minerals involved. In a granite, quartz would be one phase, biotite another, and K-spar a third. If water were present in the granite, that would be a fourth phase. Feldspars and micas occur as solid solutions with the same crystal structure but substituting ion pairs. The end members of the solid solutions may look quite different, but being the same crystal structure, they inhabit the same singular phase. As for the chemical components, our boiling water had only H2O, which, though it is made of three atoms, is considered a single chemical component due to its tendency to hang together. The complete list of major components that we will meet in the Earth's crust are as follows: O2, SiO2, TiO2, Al2O3, Fe2O3, FeO, MgO, MnO, CaO, Na2O, K2O, H2O, and CO2. I could complete this list with a few of the less abundant components, such as phosphorus, sulfur, boron, fluorine, strontium, barium, zircon, and traces of all other stable elements, but there are not a lot of minerals that take these elements in. Zircon minerals take in zircon, tourmaline takes the boron, apatite the phosphorus, and the sulfur mainly goes into sulfide minerals. These minor chemical component minerals end up being the only game in town for these elements, and as such, they act as inert, non-reactive mineral islands, passively observing the changes going on in their more reactive mineral neighbors, those with these major chemical components. In our boiling water example, we had the variables of temperature and pressure at play, and two phases, but let's complicate by adding a third phase with one of my favorite mineral polymorphs, that is, minerals with different structure but the same chemical composition. In this case, Al2SiO5 is the sole chemical component and complete chemical formula in this case, and the possible phases are the three polymorphs, kyanite, sillimanite, and andalusite. This is a PT diagram, pressure-temperature diagram, showing what regions of pressure and temperature in which each mineral is stable. They're stability fields. The lines themselves mark pressure and temperature levels where two of these three phases can coexist. These lines are like our boiling water, with two phases possible and only one chemical component, resulting in 1 degree of freedom. Two of these mineral species can coexist at a given temperature only at a specific pressure, or vice versa. Out in the middle of any field, such as over here in the middle of kyanite, there is only one phase possible, kyanite, with the one chemical component. Using the phase rule, we see this gives us 2 degrees of freedom. We now have two variables that can move independently without adjusting the system. You can go up or down in pressure, or up or down in temperature, and stay in the kyanite field. Now we see the root meaning of degrees of freedom. For the more degrees of freedom you have, the larger range of pressure and temperature in which your system can maintain its identity, not changing to new mineral forms. This is also illustrated by going in the other direction. At this point of pressure and temperature, all three phases can coexist. That's one chemical component minus three phases plus two, zero. No degrees of freedom. There is only one pressure and one temperature at which this miracle of the three in one and the one in three can take place. Any changes in pressure or temperature takes you away from this magical place where the kyanite and the sillimanite lay down with the andalusite. For this triumvirate to exist, you must be at about 3.8 kilobars, 500 degrees Celsius. No other environment will do. So let's label some chemical processes using this chart. We just met an invariant equilibrium point. Any line on this chart emanating from the invariant point is called a univariant curve or univariant reaction. Our pressure-temperature boiling water line is a univariant curve describing a univariant reaction. Out in the middle of any stability field, we can vary both pressure and temperature independently and get divariant fields. Let's step the complexity up a notch more. So far, pressure and temperature have been our only variables. But what if we add more compositional variation than just H2O or just Al2SiO5? Let's say we're in the kyanite divariant field, and we have kyanite plus mica, quartz, feldspar, and an aqueous fluid. We're up to five phases in this rock system. We can make all these phases from the chemical components of Na2O3, K2O, H2O, SiO2, and Al2O3. From the phase rule, you see that we have 2 degrees of freedom. But unlike the pure kyanite system, there is mica and feldspar, both of which can vary in their cation composition as a solid solution, remaining a single phase, but adding another variable each in their compositions. There are now 2 degrees of freedom, and not just the two variables of pressure and temperature, but four total variables. If we choose to make pressure and temperature the independent variables, then the chemical compositions of the micas and the feldspars can't be random, but must be fixed in at the values determined by the independent variables. Well, in that case, I could use my mica and feldspar compositions in such a system as geothermometers or geobarometers, telling me the range of temperature or pressure, respectively, that the rock obtained inside the earth, just by looking at the relative cation ratios in the solid solution minerals. And we have the technology to do that for the whole mineral grains, or separately investigate changes from the interior of mineral grains to their exteriors and give a pressure and temperature history of the mineral as it grew. Though we now see several variables at play, pressure, temperature, fluid pore pressure, and now chemical composition of minerals, most natural systems only have a few independent degrees of freedom. Minerals are stable and not very good geothermometers and geobarometers if they have several degrees of freedom. The fewer degrees of freedom, the more precisely the system can indicate the environment it equilibrated in. We end today looking back at our boiling water example for one more insight. Let's think about boiling water as a change in relative volume. Before the water boiled, it had this smaller volume, and now as a gas, it has this larger volume. As we go down in the earth and increase pressure, the relative change in volume steadily decreases and eventually runs to 1. This critical point is the pressure at which water can no longer boil at all, and is about 220 bars of pressure. That is not too deep, less than a kilometer down. It's even seen at the bottom of the deepest oceans. A phreatic eruption is one in which magma intrudes into water-laden rock and the water turns to steam, causing a massive explosion. Shallower than a kilometer deep, rock gets fractured by water turning to steam, with or without the power to cause surface eruptions, and eventually most of that water gets lost. The resultant rock is easily broken apart, or friable. This simply can't happen if the magma hits water-laden rock below 220 bars of pressure. The water can't turn to steam and is said to go supercritical, and the baked water-laden rock is much more tightly fused together and retains more of its water. Around 374 degrees Celsius is the temperature of water at the critical point, so non-gaseous water over 374 degrees Celsius will have to be over 220 bars of pressure and is said to be a supercritical fluid, not a liquid nor a gas. Though deep in the earth, this supercritical fluid has about the same molar volume and behavior as liquid water. As we progress further into the chemistry of metamorphic changes, you can bet those supercritical fluids are going to become supercritical agents influencing the chemistry. When we come back next time, we will uncover another layer in chemical complexity and a way used to depict this graphically to make our lives a little bit easier here on Earth Explorations.